grace be to you and peace from the God who loves us and sends us the gift of Jesus.
Amen.
Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee. Filled with the power of the Spirit. What awesome words to say at the beginning of one's ministry. I don't think there's a pastor or a baptized child of God who wouldn't want to know that she or he was filled with the power of the Spirit at the very start of their vocation. And this text doesn't say that Jesus just has the power of the Spirit. It says he's filled with the power of the Spirit. Just like those six stone jars were filled to the brim with water a few weeks ago that Jesus turned into wine. Jesus wasn't just filled, though. He was filled with power, power from the Spirit. This is strong, focused, energetic power. The Greek word for this kind of power is dunamis, from which we get our English words dynamic and dynamite. The kind of power that filled Jesus was filled with power that could turn the world upside down and inside out. This Spirit power could change the whole creation from the world as it is to the world as it should be, to the world that God imagined at the very beginning of time, and the world that God still longs for today. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, fresh from his temptation in the wilderness, which we will hear about in a few weeks. Jesus went home to begin the work that God had sent him to do. He started teaching in the synagogues throughout Galilee, and people were pretty impressed with what he had to say. Our text says he was praised by everyone. That's not too bad for a new teacher and a new preacher. When Jesus got to Nazareth, his hometown, he went to the synagogue, as was his custom, and as he stood up to read, the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. Some of us just finished reading the prophet Isaiah as we continue to wend our way through the Bible this whole year. So Jesus unrolled the scroll and found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because God has anointed me." Anointing is such a powerful word in Scripture. It was the sign of a king's or a prophet's or a priest's selection by God in the Old Testament. And anointing oil was often used. So for Jesus to say that the Spirit had anointed him was really no light thing, because he was saying that he was sent by God to do some wonderful and awesome things. The Spirit had anointed Jesus to bring good news to the poor. He was sent to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Jesus' mission was an evangelical mission, through and through. It was evangelical just like the first name of our denomination, Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. And you know, evangelical is a word that we Lutherans really do need to reclaim, because evangelical means that we are first and foremost people of good news. We are people who live and share the gospel, the good news of a gracious and loving and ever-present God who comes in the flesh to meet human need. The gospel brings salvation, it brings healing and help and hope to all the world. And like Jesus, and because of our life in Jesus, we are evangelical people. So don't let anybody say evangelicals are some Christians, because we are evangelicals too. Somebody once said that the good news is only good news when it meets the needs of people. So if somebody is dying of cancer, the good news is either healing of the body in this life or the gift of resurrected life. If a person is weighed down by guilt or shame, then then the good news, the gospel, is God's promise of forgiveness. If people are suffering or afraid, the gospel reminds them of that psalm that Luther loved, Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. One pastor said it this way: for the starving, the gospel may be bread. For a homeless refugee, the gospel may be freedom in a new homeland. For others, the gospel may be freedom from political tyranny. God's action, God's message, God's word to a particular person, to a particular need, to a particular historical situation. He says you don't throw a drowning person a sandwich. However good the sandwich may be, it just doesn't meet the person's need. You throw a drowning person a life jacket, or you dive in for the rescue. And it's the same with the gospel. And that's what Jesus came to preach, to teach, and to live. After Jesus finished reading from the scroll, Isaiah, he rolled it up, gave it back to the attendant, and he sat down as any rabbi would do. And everybody was looking at him intently, sort of like you're looking at me. The text said the eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And then Jesus began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." A few weeks ago, people all over the country were celebrating the birthday of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. St. John's was actually filled from 9 o'clock in the morning till about 3 o'clock, filled with everybody from neighboring Boy Scout troops to our new mayor, Norma Ratis, our relatively new school superintendent, June Chang, filled with people who were here to learn more about Dr. King's life. And in his name, people did community service all over Summit and really all over the country. Many speeches were given, his sermons were read, and everybody loved hearing about Dr. King's dream. But some of us wonder, like Langston Hughes did, that wonderful African-American poet, what happens to a dream that gets deferred? What happens when the dream doesn't get realized? Hughes says, what happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun, or fester like a sore and then run? Does it stink like rotten meat, or crust and sugar over like a syrupy sweet? Maybe it just sags like a heavy load. Or does it explode? A few weeks ago, people all over the United States were joining hands and singing, "We shall overcome." Maybe some of you sang that too. It's a beautiful song. It was like the battle hymn of the civil rights movement. And I've been singing it ever since I was a child. But brothers and sisters, we can sing about someday for a long, long time, while things keep getting worse for people who are oppressed and for our planet, the Earth. Someday war will end, and we won't have to pray for the people of Syria or Somalia, Iraq or Israel. Someday, people will be more important than profit or saving money. And we won't have to worry about places like Flint, Michigan. The people of Flint have been contaminated by lead in their water since April of 2014 because the state of Michigan, my home state, decided that it wanted to save money by switching the water sources. General Motors pulled out in 2014 because that water was corroding their auto parts, but the state kept serving the water to the people. They lied to the people and said, the water being put out meets all of our drinking water standards, and Flint water is safe to drink. Someday, hunger around the world is going to be eradicated, and in this country, one out of four children won't have to worry about where their next meal is going to come from. Someday, people won't be killed because of the color of their skin or demeaned because their religion is different. Someday, global warming is going to end, and we won't have to worry about making sure that our children have a beautiful earth. Listen again to this news flash from the gospel. Today, says Jesus, today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. Today, the good news that Jesus taught and preached and lived was not some kind of pie in the sky, by and by gospel. Jesus didn't say we shall overcome someday. He said today. This scripture has been fulfilled today. The poor are being brought good news, like the food that was served this morning up in the Home Depot parking lot in Passaic. That's good news given to the poor. Today, captives are being released, whether they're released from captivity to the heroin addiction that is so plaguing our country and especially our youth, or they're being released from detention centers, where they're held because they're undocumented immigrants simply wanting a safe place to live. Today, says Jesus, this scripture is being fulfilled. That's what his first sermon was all about. And it was given not only to the people of his day, but to us, his followers, who would continue to live the gospel, to live it not only with our words, but with our lives, so that we would be healers in this wounded world. Just as the Spirit of the Lord was upon Jesus and anointed him, every single one of us here has been anointed, from young to old, rich to poor, black, white, Christian, Muslim, non-believer. Every single one of us have been anointed by the Spirit, anointed there with that water that was given to us in our baptism. And I often say that the only ism that can conquer all of the other isms, militarism, classism, racism, sexism, is baptism. It's the only one that can bring us together as the people of God to do what it is that God needs us to do. Today, at our congregational meeting that we will process out to in just a little bit, we're going to hear all the ways in which we at St. John's have tried to follow Jesus by bringing good news to the poor, release to the captives, justice to the oppressed. And today, God willing, we will commit ourselves anew through our time, our talents, our money to do what it is that God wants us to do. So let this be our prayer that we're going to sing right now. Unite us, anoint us, O Spirit of love. For you are within us, around and above. Equip us for service. Your gifts you bestow. In Christ is our calling. In Christ may we grow. And in Christ may we go. Amen.